Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me. It was a long day for all of us. And some of the things that I will say are probably not entirely new for those who have attended the whole day, but some things may be new. So let's see. So I will talk about the implications of digitalization for currency competition. And it was already said, this idea of currency competition dates back to Hayek, who wrote this book, Denationalization of Money, in 1976. And he had the feeling this is a kind of panacea for the global monetary system. There will be no longer inflation, and we get a stable monetary system if we introduce currency competition. I had the chance to write my PhD dissertation on this, and but when it came out, nobody was interested in currency competition, and so it took some decades until this topic came up again. So what was inspiring Hayek was the idea that money issued under a government monopoly, in his view, is always bound to end up in inflation. And in fact, when he wrote this book in 1976, that was a period when inflation started to get up in the United States after a very long period of very low inflation rates. And so I think that was inspiring him. You can see here the spike in the inflation rate after a relatively peaceful period concerning inflation. And so that was his idea. Government money leads inevitably to inflation, and in order to stop this inflation, we need private monies, we need money competition. And the idea is, what kind of money did he have in mind? His idea was, well, it has to be both. It must be physical money in terms of banknotes, and it must be also digital money held with banks. And initially, the idea was this money has to be backed, in a sense, by a convertibility promise. So the idea that if you have this private money, you have the right to exchange it at a fixed rate into the existing currencies. But his idea was that this was just needed in the beginning, that over time this connection gets looser, and the idea was, in the end, this private money does not need to be convertible. As he said, it seems neither necessary nor desirable that the issuing bank legally commits itself to maintain the value of its unit. So that was just a kind of inconvertible money. And what is quite interesting, if you talk about now the more modern forms of currency competition, to look what Hayek's idea was concerning the management of these currencies. And the idea is, he said, yes, what is important is that these private monies have a stable purchasing power. They must be somehow stable. That's what is required. And then the idea was, okay, yes, the private issuers will be under much stronger incentive to keep this money stable than monopolists. Well, that's Hayek's worldview, that competition is always better than the government. And then what is quite interesting, and I think that's very relevant then for all those who have in mind, who have the idea to issue private monies, cryptocurrencies, what is really important, he said, the issuing institution could achieve this result by regulating the quantity of its issue. So I think that's really important, that he sees the issuer of the currency as an active agent trying to respond to changes in the value of this currency by regulating the quantity of issue. And we will see that, in my view, this is one of the main flaws of all the cryptocurrencies, that the quantity is not really regulated. It just comes out it is issued, but there's no plan behind it, no idea how to regulate the value of this currency when the value is fluctuating, what we just observed. And of course, his idea is, this is the best of all practical methods of regulating the quantity of media of exchange. Well, and Thomas Mayer has just again also now proclaimed this idea of currency competition as a kind of innovation for the European monetary union. So, if we talk about competition of money and monies, I think it's really important to have a kind of taxonomy. And I think the money flower invented by the BIS has already been presented here in some form, and I think it's a very good way to organize the thinking on monies. And I will right now present you a money flower, but it's a little bit different than the BIS money flower, at least in one dimension. So my taxonomy has private money versus money issued by the government. That's what the BIS money flower has. Electronic money versus physical money. Again, that's also something, a dimension that the BIS has. But then the main difference for me is that I have the dimension money with a fixed rate convertibility guaranteed by the issuer, versus what I call fiat money with no convertibility commitment. I think that's a very important dimension which the BIS money flower does not contain. And I think that makes a huge difference whether the money that you issue provides a convertibility promise at a fixed rate, or whether you just issue a fiat money. We'll see what's happening. I do not adopt any convertibility promise. And I think it's important to add this kind of dimension. And then finally, a centralized accounting mechanism versus a decentralized accounting mechanism, kind of peer-to-peer. And as a result, we get this wonderful money flower, looks similar to the BIS money flower. And I think it's quite helpful to use this to organize our thinking. And I have the most important, what I will discuss now is, well, here we have, unfortunately, it's a little bit small here, but these are our traditional bank deposits. Well, they are convertible at a fixed rate, or bank deposits, because they are convertible into central bank money, into bank notes, so it's convertible. Then here we have the central bank reserves, or the central bank digital currency, which is not yet there, which is public, electronic, and what is important, non-convertible, because it's everything with the central bank is just no convertibility promise. Then here we have Bitcoin with the dimension electronic, peer-to-peer, non-convertible, and what do we have? Electronic, peer-to-peer, non-convertible, and private. So that's the dimension of the Bitcoin. And of course, with this, the nice, and of course, we have here our traditional cash, peer-to-peer, public, non-convertible, and non-electronic. The nice thing with this, you can play with this, and the BIS guys did it, and you can, so to say, create your own synthetic monies. By just combining these features, you can have your own money. So you can make it even more complicated if you add a fifth dimension, and that's what the BIS money flower has. They differentiate between money which is generally accessible and money which is not generally accessible. This is helpful in some degree with the central bank digital currencies versus central bank reserves. So you could also add this fifth dimension, but I think four dimensions is already quite a bit. Anyhow, so I think that's helpful to organize the thinking about monies. And so what I do in the following is just discuss three areas where currency competition could take place in a world with digitalization. The first is the competition between traditional banknotes and traditional digital money. The second is a competition of traditional bank deposits and banknotes versus cryptocurrencies. And then the third thing, which we have discussed already intensively, is traditional bank deposits versus central bank digital currencies. I think these are three areas which I would like to discuss shortly. I think these, in my view, are the most relevant fields that we should discuss first. The first one is the competition of cash versus traditional bank deposits. We've seen in Sweden this process has gone already very far. In the euro area, so far not so much has happened. There's still a lot of payments made in cash. We see that the share of cash in the money stock M1 has declined, but still not so much has been happening. But I think the interesting thing is that this could change drastically, because now we have this new technology of this touchless payment with credit cards for all payments below 25 euros, and the study of the ECB that I've used for the statistics shows that 80%, or I think it's 81% of all payments are below 25 euros. So I think while so far cash has held its position relatively well, this could change relatively soon. If people realize this wonderful technology that you can just just take your card and can pay without any complications. It will be a little bit more difficult maybe in Germany. In Germany, I don't know why Germans are so fond of money. It always reminds me, you may all remember these old telephones that we had in earlier times, yeah? And we had to dial, and sometimes I think in Germany, we are like people who say, well, it's so nice to have these wonderful old telephones and instead of using these modern ones. So similar preference for this old-fashioned cash, at least for our daily payments. But anyhow, but I'm sure that this will change drastically. And of course, a cashless society would be interesting. We would have no more bank runs. The zero lower bound would be removed. But even if we see, and I expect this, a drastic reduction of the use of cash in our daily payments, as long as cash is not altogether abolished by the government, it does not really have any implications for monetary policy. Because as long cash is available, as long as people have access to cash, if you have bank runs, people will demand cash. If you go in the negative terrain with interest rates, cash will reappear. So in order to have a fundamental change, cash would have to be abolished altogether. But I don't think that we have this in our lifetime. So I've made some years ago gave an interview without thinking too much about the implications for Der Spiegel, and said, well, we can abolish cash because honestly, I think I don't need it. And then the Spiegel brought this interview, and it created a shitstorm and wave of very aggressive emails. And so I said, no, you can have your money, you can have your cash. If you're happy with it, you can live with it. But I'm sure in Germany, this will not change so much. So here we will see diminished use of cash in transactions drastically, but I think as long as cash is there and people can have cash as a kind of asset of the last resort, I think this we don't want to see the change. So then what about this competition of Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies versus traditional bank deposits, or maybe also cash? And the question is, what features does Bitcoin have? Well, it's a fiat money, like banknotes and central bank digital currencies, because Bitcoin does not entail any promise by the issuer. It's not, if you have Bitcoin, you cannot go to the issuer and say, please give me dollars or something else. It's a decentralized accounting mechanism, this distributed ledger like banknotes. It's electronic like deposits and central bank reserves, and it's private like deposits held with commercial banks. In my view, the most important feature of Bitcoin is this inconvertibility, and this inconvertibility makes it logically identical to base money, that is to banknotes or to bank reserves or central bank digital currencies. Interesting is the way how Bitcoins are issued, and here is a major difference to the issuance of classical monetary base, because monetary base is normally issued by transactions. Central banks buy foreign exchange reserves, they buy bonds, they provide refinancing loans, and so it's always in transactions. And with Bitcoin and most cryptocurrencies, they are created without transactions. I think that was all the Fulgate people also somehow have some preference for that. And someone can regard Bitcoin just as a form of helicopter money. Yeah? Because there's no accounting position which you need to balance. It on the balance sheet, it just comes out of the blue. And of course, Bitcoins then are distributed by selling them against traditional currencies. So the question is then, how will this process of currency competition be determined? And well, there we have to go to these traditional functions of money, and we all know them. And I think one has to differentiate for these functions between money as an object and between money as a unit of account or unit of measurement. Money as an object, of course, means of payment and store of value. But what I think is important for money as a store of value, because we have many stores of value. Everything can be a store of value. You can buy paintings or furniture or I don't know what, forests. But I think the interesting thing for money as a store of value is that it is a safe asset. And we know I think that's the experience of the last few years, and many people are discussing that there is a huge demand for safe assets. So in order to qualify as a store of value, money must be somehow a safe asset. And then we have the second dimension, that's money as a unit of account or unit of measurement. And there it's clear, unit of measurement is like a meter or a kilogram. Yeah, so that's what unit of measurement means. Yeah, so it's something which is not variable. And the interesting thing is, when the mark was invented in 1871, it was a weight. It was a certain amount of gold. I think one divided by 2,790 kilogram gold or something. So it was, the mark was a weight. It was not something abstract. And so money as a unit of account, a unit of measurement, it's obvious it must be stable. Yeah, because if a meter is this or this or this, so if the definition of a meter varies over time, of a kilogram, you have a problem. Yeah, because then it doesn't function. Yeah, and therefore, of course, in these functions as a unit of account, a unit of measurement, of course, stability is paramount. Yeah, and the functions, you know, it's a numerator. The numerator helps you to compare prices of goods of two different goods at the same time. It helps you to compare prices of goods at different points in time. Then you have the function of a standard of deferred payment, which helps you, if I give somebody some money, how much will I get back, and to measure that what I get back is somehow equivalent to what I gave. And then, of course, an important function is also money as a unit of account in accounting, bookkeeping. So in order to measure has the net worth of a company increased or not, then for this you also need money as a unit of account. So if these are the areas of currency competition, so what qualities are needed? And I would say there are two dimensions. There's a liquidity dimension and the stability dimension for the means of payment function. Of course, the liquidity dimension is decisive. If you have the most wonderful money and then you don't get your food at night because people don't accept it, you must go to bed hungry. It's not especially my stomach, who is very hungry always, would be found a terrible story when you told me you were running around yesterday evening, don't get your food because you only have your credit card. So of course the liquidity function matters, and of course the other dimension is the stability dimension. And stability does not necessarily mean that it's 100% stable. I think what really matters is that you can anticipate it, that it's predictable how the value of money changes. So you have these two dimensions. Interestingly, high excess, the stability dimension is more important, is what matters most, and it's more important than the liquidity dimension. That was his idea, and I think he's right, because if you think about this means of payment function, in Germany still it's maybe a problem, but over time the whole payments process will be done by payment system. Yeah, we will be no longer, I think in 5 or 10 years time, you no longer need money to make payments. The payment by itself is made with the payment system. Yeah, what you need is then a means of settlement for the payment system. When you get your bill from the credit card company once a month, you need something to settle it. Yeah, but for the payment itself, you no longer need money in a sense of a physical object that you give something to someone. You just need the credit card system, an accounting system, and then you need a means of settlement. Once you get, once per month, you get your bill from the credit card company, then you need the means of settlement, and this can be dollars, can be euros, can whatever. So I think the stability dimension is decisive, like Hayek believes, and the question is, how can we make currencies stable? How can we create this stability? And here, if you compare the cryptocurrencies, traditional bank deposits, banknotes, and reserves, the question is what makes cryptocurrencies stable? What is the stability component? And one thing how to make money stable is that the issuer says, okay, I provide a convertibility obligation. So whenever I issue a currency and I promise everybody who has this currency gets from me, I don't know, dollars or euros. So you can make convertibility promise to make it stable, but that's not what cryptocurrency, what Bitcoin and most cryptocurrencies are all about. Then what also can help, because banknotes and reserves and central bank deposits have also no convertibility promise, but if a currency is a legal tender, that can be helpful, because you know, then whenever I have a debt, I can pay with a legal tender. So it has no legal tender, it has no convertibility obligation. And then, are there any mechanisms how to stabilize the value? And what the cryptocurrencies do is they set a certain amount they announce a certain amount of the currency that will be issued. So they say, okay, you can be sure we will not supply more than, I don't know, 20 million, 1 million, I think, with Bitcoin. But the question is, does this help? And if one problem is that if one cryptocurrency has a fixed limit for supply, there are maybe hundreds or thousands of cryptocurrencies. So if the one issuer says, I keep it stable, the overall supply of cryptocurrencies is infinite. And the idea of currency competition is that there are many, many coming. Yeah? And so there's a risk that there's one cryptocurrency, but then the market jumps from one to the next. And overall, there is no limit for the aggregate supply of these cryptocurrencies. And finally, that's what Hayek said, there is, so far at least, as these cryptocurrencies are organized, there is no policy to regulate the value of these currencies. And the result you can see, that's why you get this huge volatility, because there's no one there who tries to regulate the value of this currency. Yeah? And I think that's really something that I think Hayek has made this very clear. If you issue currencies, you also have to do something to keep the value stable, because otherwise you get these ups and downs. And of course, this instability is then something that makes it impossible, that makes it extremely difficult for a cryptocurrency or any privately issued currencies to drive out the national currencies out of circulation. Yeah? Because here you can say, if you take the euro and the ECB, so far they have been quite successful in regulating that money. Yeah? So you can make many, criticize a lot with the ECB, but as far as the value of the euro is concerned, the inflation rate, it was wonderfully close to the ECB's target, much closer than the D-mark or any other dollar or anything. Yeah, so we can criticize a lot, but the ECB has really been able to come really close to this 2%. Yeah? And so so of course they manage it actively. They do thousands of things. We're told this morning how all the instruments are used, but so far one can say the ECB has been fairly successful in this. Yeah? And I don't see right now. So I'm not one of these theorists who see the world going down or under. So far I don't see that this will change. Anyhow, so in my view, one of the main problems of these cryptocurrencies is really that they are not regulated, that the overall supply is not limited, and as a result, they will never be stable enough to have any chance to compete out the existing currencies out of circulation. So yes, that's what I already said. So I think they don't have to repeat this. So then we have the final thing, something that schwierig here. What's it since here? It's very sensitive. Either it doesn't work at all, or something.
Point at the computer behind you. Point at the computer behind you.
Ah, here. Ah, good. Yeah. Okay. Then final topic that was addressed here very often today. These central bank digital currencies, and I think this is something that could really be a game changer. I think, however you do it institutionally, whether you do it as a kind of separate asset, with kind of separate features, or whether you do it as kind of full substitute for reserves and bank and cash. So my ideal form of these CBDCs would be say, okay, it's a full substitute for cash and for central bank reserves. And in this form, I think I see a huge potential for this form of money, because we have now these new rules for a bank resolution in Europe, and these forms of bank resolution say, okay, whenever you have a bank deposit that exceeds 100,000 euros, you always have to be aware that there's a risk of a bail-in. Yeah, because that's what this regulation says. There must be a bail-in, first of all. And so if you are a company and you have 1 million or 2 million of euros, which is not that much money, yeah, you have it with some, but I say no bank names, but with some German bank, yeah, and there's always a risk, you wake up in the morning and you find out this bank has crashed. And your money is probably not all gone, but you get a bail-in. That's what the idea is. I find this always not a very good idea, because the idea is, well, as if you deposit with your money with the bank, you have to check whether the bank is healthy or not. Yeah, but that's absurd. It's like when you fly Ryanair and it crashes, then they say, yeah, you knew it's cheaper. Yeah, so you should have known that. So you better fly Lufthansa. But I cannot go on the airport and say, let me go around the plane and check whether everything is okay. And that's the same thing with banks. How can you, as a company, even if you are Siemens or some, how can you check the health of Deutsche Bank? Look at the balance sheet. It's absurd. Yeah. So the idea that there is a kind of market discipline by the depositors checking the health of the bank is as absurd as the idea going to the airport, say, I want to check the Ryanair jet whether it's safe. Yeah. It's as absurd as the other. And therefore, it's obvious that there would be huge interest, especially by larger companies, in these deposits. And so once you open up this possibility, I assume that you might even come to a kind of corner solution. Yeah, so because then you have this competition and you have the 100% safe one and you have the not so safe one, at least if you have more than 100,000 euros, it could lead to a corner solution. Because that, I think especially for my bank deposits, I want them safe. Yeah, so if I have other kind of investments, it's a different story. But the people who hold money with banks as a deposit, they want to have it safe, because otherwise I would not hold it as a bank deposit, but would find better investments. Yeah, and so there is huge potential in this. The implications for central banks, yes, there was this risk of digital bank runs. In your model, it's different, but I must say I have not 100% understood how it works. I have to read this in more detail. So I have the more simple, I think that's more the Swedish, so my approach is a little bit more the Swedish approach. That, and as I see these digital currencies, there's also no need to regulate it, because it's just the market. People have their bank deposits, yeah, and they exchange it into the central bank reserves. Yeah? And so the central bank itself would have no issuing rule or mechanism for that. It's just the banks that make loans, create deposits, and with this deposit they go to the bank, to the central bank, and then it is exchanged. Nice thing with these digital currencies for monetary policy, you could have helicopter money if everybody has this account, which would be very nice. And what also is interesting, I think that was already also said, once you have it, it doesn't necessarily mean that you have so many transactions, what was your point? Yeah. So of course it would be a problem if I buy a cup of coffee and this all goes on this central bank account. That would be a monster. But the idea again is to have these kind of payments providers. Yeah, and that is what already said by you, I think, in the morning, that I have to stop now. So the idea is again that I use this digital currency as a settlement money. Once a month, the settlement will be made, and then you can have all kind of payments providers doing for me all the payment services, and this bank, central bank deposit, is just the settlement account for that. I also don't see another way, because if the central banks would have the sole responsibility for providing credit cards and payment systems, that's absurd. Yeah? And so I think it would be very nice to have it, and then you could really you could give payments providers the possibility to provide services without being a bank, and then you would have less transactions. which was a problem of Michael. Okay, so the idea is we could have kind of market-driven process. Yeah, if you just open it up, where the market just decides whether they want this kind of CBDCs, and it's interesting. So the major challenge, and that we can discuss it here, is how to refinance the banks. Yeah, because that's a problem. Because then, if all the deposits go to the central bank, of course the central bank has to fill the gap with the commercial banks, and then the question is, will it accept all the loans as collateral, which it could do? But that's is an open question. So interesting. The question was, you were asked this morning, how is it legally? Who will decide it? In Germany, I found it's quite interesting. It could be decided overnight, because the Bundesbank is allowed to do business with everybody in the Bundesbank Act. It's quite interesting. So the Bundesbank could tomorrow say, nobody here from the Bundesbank? No. otherwise, on Monday, they could say, oh yes, starting Monday, everybody can open an account with the Bundesbank. It's quite interesting. So I knew that because I was once in my youth a civil servant for the Deutsche Bundesbank, and every civil servant of the Deutsche Bundesbank was allowed to have a bank account with the Deutsche Bundesbank. So I actually had already these CBDCs with the Deutsche Bundesbank. But interestingly, they could do it overnight. Okay, so let me stop here. So the potential for currency competition will increase. Role of cash will be reduced, but as long as there's no political will to abolish cash, this will not change the situation. I'm skeptical whether the cryptocurrencies have a chance to establish themselves as really dominant currencies, driving out the national currencies. Of course, there will be also pockets for people who like to have sleepless nights, and want. So of course there will be some demand, but it's not in a sense that you say the cryptocurrencies will really run the show. And the central bank deposits is really a fascinating thing, and we have discussed it from different angles, and it definitely needs probably another conference to go in more detail. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So, limited of time again. Short questions. Are there any?
Thank you. I just want to second your, we've talked a little bit about how to technically implement this. And I think a way to move forward is, we already have the PSD2, which obliges banks to open up their AFIs, as I believe it's called, for third-party payment service providers. And I think a way to implement CBDC without the central bank having to worry too much about technicalities is simply to do the same thing for the central bank. So the central bank opens up its API is what it's called, like the interface, and then leave it up to third-party service provider. And I think they are already out there. There's already third-party payment initiation providers out there who have all the technology. So I don't think this, I totally agree with you. I don't think the central bank needs to worry too much about having to clear, I don't know how many million transactions, because I think these other parties can kind of do that for them.
You would need one for each citizen, and then you would have the settlement stuff, and then would...
Yeah, yeah, you could imagine then you'd have maybe, I don't know, 20 of them or 50 of them, or then, and they would have to clear mutually. But I think you could that would be the solution. It's also a way to kind of sell it politically, to say, oh yeah, now we have PSD2, let's have PSD3, and then we have central bank digital currency.
Okay, so I don't have to answer
yeah,
this?
Yeah, no, it's just a comment, yeah.
Ah, okay. Yeah, we are talking a lot of currency competition now, and you said it's impossible for a consumer to check whether a bank is solid or not. But the same thing is with cryptocurrencies. How could a consumer say a cryptocurrency is solid or not? And I think with the private creation of cryptocurrency is a lot of danger to be a quite unfair game. Remember the history of Bitcoin. If you were in the beginning of Bitcoin, you're a multiple millionaire. Yeah? And how is this justified? Only by money creation? I'm not convinced that this is a good game.
Well, so I fortunately wrote an article in Frankfurt Allgemeine Zeitung in January where I was very skeptical about Bitcoin, and so I feel feel quite reassured.
Okay. So I think we should wrap it up here. Thank you very much. Vielen Dank.